Hi, I'm Lisa Prather, and welcome to The Voice of Health with our host, Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice, where lives are changed every day through the natural approach to healthcare. So what are we going to talk about today?
Our favorite subject, stress.
Favorite subject or something we need to talk about, huh?
Well, I'll tell you, as a physician, of course, everybody's been hearing about the Obamacare and all the different requirements and all the changes in healthcare, and we're going through that in a huge way.
Mm-hmm.
We're switching over to electronic health records. We are shifting the way that we do our entire practice, who we have in there, documentation. All the different requirements and the changes that are occurring, the reduced fees that occur with increased expenses. and also, you know, we have more people that we have to employ.
Mm-hmm.
So we are actually in a what we would call a stress situation.
We're sharing
and
that.
We're sharing that. And
I had one patient, about a couple of weeks ago. She said, "You guys work hard." You know, she's a business owner.
Sure.
And she sees how hard we work.
Right, right.
And I'm all, "Thank you." Is that something, you know, to be thankful for? Or are we, you know, working too hard that it's causing, you know, stress in our lives.
And that's what we want to, you know, talk about. You know, what is the balance in life? What kind of effects that has?
Because we're all about homeostasis.
We're all about homeostasis, and we're all about health.
Mm-hmm.
So applying this to our own lives is something that's very important, and we can use a lot of that information for our patients. Because, quite frankly, stress is probably the main reason that people come into us.
Mm-hmm.
And accounts for, you know, a tremendous amount of the diseases, and how much stress actually, you know, contributes to our disease state. You know, there's different theories on that, but, you know, there is a huge correlation on the amount of stress that we have and the disease states that we actually experience. And, you know, nutrition plays a very huge role on that. You know, the toxins that we receive, all those different types of things, but easily the stress can account for, you know, 30% of our disease states.
Wow, 30%. And so this show's for us. Are we doing this show?
We are doing this show for us and then sharing it with the audience out there.
The listeners, yeah.
Because we want to keep healthy. And actually, if you can control your stress, your production goes up.
Mm-hmm.
That is one thing that people have found, that you actually accomplish more when you can actually find that homeostasis.
Mm-hmm.
A very interesting thing is that, you know, Henry Ford was the first person to implement the 40-day work week.
Mm-hmm.
And Henry Ford was a great man, but he wasn't certainly a socialist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the reason that he implemented the 40-hour work week is that as he did studies on his employees, he found that he was actually wasting his money by working people more than 40 hours.
Mm.
So that if they were working, you know, 50 hours, that 10 hours that he paid for them, he really wasn't getting his money's worth.
Yeah, we had a patient come in the other day, and he was tracking his hours the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
He worked 400 hours overtime each year.
Each year, right.
Yeah, which has to affect your health.
Yes.
Wasn't it, you know, on the onset of the computers and technology, we were supposed to have less hours per week?
Yeah,
hasn't it created us working
more hours?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And you know, one of the main things is to, you know, work smarter, not harder.
Mm-hmm.
And be productive with what we're doing, because as we're going to talk about, you know, actually, once you go over, they found over 60 hours, as you're going over 40 hours of work,
mm-hmm.
Your production actually starts to decrease with each hour that you actually work over.
Mm-hmm.
if you actually hit 60 hours, then there's actually a negative effect, so that even the 40 hours you're working isn't really producing anything.
So it just becomes a track of my hours. I'm scared. I don't really want to know.
So, you know, it actually, you know, if you overwork, it actually becomes a negative, you know, to the time that you put in. So it's actually, you know, it's something that we need to find out what is the right amount of stress. And there is a homeostasis, and we talk about homeostasis in everything.
Well, you just said something. We're going to have stress in our lives. That's just part of life, correct?
Oh, and actually, a very interesting thing is no stress in your life is actually not good for you.
Yeah, what would that be like? a
good, healthy range on that, and we'll talk about some of the, is about 20% is stressful in our life and 80% is relaxation. That is actually what they have found is a good, healthy balance, because you need some stress stimulation in your life to actually keep a good homeostasis and keep everything working properly. So, you know, we're not talking about a stress-free life. That's not really what we're looking for. What we're looking for is a control, a balance, a thought process to actually, you know, put your life into homeostasis, balance.
How to manage it.
And how to manage it.
Interesting, we manage ours in different ways, and we'll talk about that later.
Very good, and we are two different people on that, and that's one of the things that you have to find out, because everyone's homeostasis and how they, you know, there's general rules on that, but how they actually deal with it and how they respond to things are completely different.
Okay. So what is stress, if you had to define it?
Well, stress. One of the things is that there has been actually a lot of research on stress. The first person who actually came up that stress was a factor in one's health was someone called Hans Selye. And in 1936, he wrote and did some experimentations and published what was called the General Adaptation Syndrome. Now, there's been a lot of work on it since then and a lot of redefining, but his main point was that stress on the bodies, and that can be a lot of different types of ways, was the major cause of disease. And actually, he did some very, very excellent experimentation where he found that stress would cause hormonal collapses, that it would actually cause digestive failure. It actually would lead to, you know, as we're talking about, you know, the whole process on that, cardiovascular disease, cancer, you know, all the different types of things that we're talking about, it can actually lead to a breakdown and a premature aging of the body. One of the things that I promote and talk about is that all creatures live to be 10 times their age of puberty, and I'm talking about biological age. So, you know, the mayfly reaches sexual maturity at one day, and they live to be 10 days old. If you look at our cats and dogs, you know, they reach a sexual maturity at about a year, and they live to be about 12 years old. You know, as you're looking at each of the different types of animals out there, they naturally will live to be 10 times their age of puberty. Humans actually will reach sexual maturity at about, somewhere between 12 and 16, depending on each individual. So we should be living to be about 120 to 160 years old, which is biologically actually what we reach. But we are under...
It's just how quickly we reach it.
Yeah, just how quickly we're... you know, because there's chronological age, which is your number of years, then there's biological age, which is a measurement of the aging of your body. And there are scientific ways to actually figure that out. And different organs can age at different rates. And when they wear out, then we get into the whole, early death and... disease and all those types of things. And people actually reach that at different times. And so, you know, as we are looking at this, every time that you do not handle stress well, you know, if everything is not going as it should, then we start to get into the premature aging, the creation of disease, the breakdown of the different areas. You know, you're talking about all sorts of things that usually come from that. You're talking about, you know, insomnia, depression, anxiety. The hormones, it's the leading reason that we have hormonal failure that's going on. You know, what are all the different signs that you're looking for? You know, you're talking about digestive problems, you know, can really start kicking up from that. You know, we were talking about the insomnia, the depression, the mood swings. One of the biggest things is if you're overstressed, then you have a loss of libido. Is one of the early signs along those lines.
That's an early sign, yeah.
So, you know, as we're looking at these things, that all needs to be considered.
Okay. You can win a free 60-minute massage in a relaxing spa at the Prather Practice. Each month, we have a drawing to give away a free massage to one of our lucky Facebook and Twitter fans. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. This is The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. Congratulations to Nancy, one of our Facebook fans who won the June drawing for a free massage in our luxury spa. The Voice of Health Wellness Tip with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice. How can acupuncture help pain?
I've had many, many patients said that the acupuncture worked better than their cortisone shots for the pain relief. And not only that, but it was, they could do it as often as they wanted to. So it's a very, very nice type of thing. And we use the acupuncture a tremendous amount for any type of inflammatory or painful condition. Very, very excellent relief.
Well, in a way, is this how pain works? When one of those roadways are blocked, then you have pain, correct?
Correct.
And acupuncture kind of opens that up.
Opens it up, redirects it. Absolutely. And we get amazing inflammatory relief. I mean, you know, that's one of the things that, we see on a regular basis. And we get quite a few referrals for pain relief from the acupuncture with excellent results.
What if someone's thinking acupuncture, you know, and they're afraid of needles?
Well, the nice thing is that we have, well, first off, the needles are as thin as a hair. When people think about needles, they think about a hypodermic needle. And you can put probably at least five, maybe ten of those needles in one hypodermic needle. So they're very, very thin. Also, they're rounded on the end. They're not sharp. So, you know, that you get very seldom do you get any bleeding. It's more of a toxic release if there is. But that will actually go in and kind of go between the skin cells. So there's very little problems. A lot of people compare it to a mosquito bite. The other thing is if you are just not going to do needles, we have lots of different alternatives. There's laser, there's electrical, we have an acupowder. I have several patients who do not even ever want me to show them a needle. They will pass out just like that.
Well, a lot of times you don't even feel it.
Well, you don't. You really don't. Matter of fact, I had a patient who was laying down, and she says, "No, I'm deathly afraid of needles." And we're talking, and I'm sitting there putting needles in her, and we're going on and on. And she's laying face down, and she says, "Okay, tell me when you start."
You had already put
it. I had already done it.
That was sneaky.
She thought it was fun. Well, I wasn't playing. I wasn't trying to be sneaky. It just went that way. And that she says, sneaky. "Oh, you're kidding. I thought you were just checking the points." She said, "I didn't even feel it."
Schedule your appointment at the Prather Practice, 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Or learn more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. The Prather Practice, restoring hope.
And I'm feeling good.
You're listening to The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice, the most comprehensive wellness center in the Midwest. Today, we're talking about stress and how it affects our health. In our first segment, we started talking about the effects stress has on our health and... let's talk a little bit. You had mentioned the general adaptation syndrome. What exactly is that? And I know there's stages involved.
Certainly. There, you know, when you actually become stressed, there is a natural response of the body where there is, first off, change in the hormonal system, in the nervous system. The digestive system actually shuts down, slows down quite considerably because the body's actually putting blood into the muscles. So there's a whole response, and basically you're getting ready to either fight or run, what they call the fight flight.
Sympathetic
nervous system kicks in, and basically what's happening is if a tiger walks into the cave that you were living in, the last thing you want to do is to, worrying about digesting your meal.
Right.
You know, you have to be ready to fight it or run. Mm. And so, you know, your body's ready to go. And sometimes you can even have some superhuman type strength, you know, to actually handle the situation. Well, we don't have too many tigers right now, but we have a lot of other things that are going on. You know, we can have a boss that's yelling at us, or in our case, employees that are giving, you know, problems. And the problem is that oftentimes the way that we should be responding to that is not actually socially appropriate now. Mm-hmm. So your body gets really worked up and you're under a tremendous amount of stress, and it's real difficult to hit somebody or to run away because you have to be there.
Right.
So we have social mores right now that can actually, you know, keep us from going into the next stage, which is what they call the resistance stage. That's where you have the changes that take place in your body. You have the physical desire to actually do something about it. And if you actually have some physical activity, you get a release on that, then the body goes back into homeostasis naturally. Mm-hmm. Okay? So there's a release along those lines, and we then start to reshift back into a homeostasis. Now, again, I said that actually having that response on a periodic basis is actually good. About 20% of the time in as we're dealing with things. But if you go for 8 hours in a day where you're in that first stage, the alarm stage, that is not healthy.
Yeah, first stage where you're in that sympathetic mode. Is that what you mean?
Where you're in that fight flight stage.
And you have nowhere to go.
No
punching bag.
You can't really hit something. You can't run away. Or there's a reassurance of, oh, the tiger just moved on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't have that shift back into homeostasis where your body's actually shifting back to its normal stage. Then you actually, if that continues for a long period of time, then you get into an exhaustion stage. Because the body is not built to go over 20% on an average in a day. If that's on a continual basis where it's constantly going, the homeostasis is completely off in the body, and you start to get a disease state where they would actually find that the adrenals would shrink, there would be changes in the thyroid, pituitary function wouldn't be up to par. Your digestive system isn't working right. You actually start to see ulcers. There is a change in the whole pH of the body, so the chemical reactions aren't working right. The hormones shift into the system, because one of the things is if you're being chased by the tiger, last thing you want to be thinking about is sex. So that whole area just kind of shuts down in your system. And, your body is constantly doing that, and you start to put on weight. It's one of the largest reasons that people get fat, especially in the mid, where you start to see the swelling into the gut. Your thyroid starts not working well. Your adrenals, you can't think because the chemistry in your brain's not working right. You can't, there's actually a decrease in IQ. If you're caught up in that, the last thing you want to do is fall down and go to sleep so you can't sleep anymore. You see all these different types of patterns, and if you're stuck in that, your, you know, how are you going to be, you know, the main thing that you're trying to do is accomplish different things in production. You know, we're thinking about what we need to do to be productive in our, you know, in our management of our office. And if you get stuck in that, you cannot be productive.
Hmm.
You know, you are actually defeating yourself before you even begin. Mm-hmm. So the basic things that you're looking to accomplish are no longer, you are no longer capable of doing them, which actually then creates a whole nother stress response.
Right.
So you get stress on top of stress because now you can't do the things that you need to do. So there has to be a backing off on that, a recharging of the system to actually get back into a productive state where you're actually thinking clearly, where your body actually has the energy to actually accomplish the neat things that you need to do. And you have to get back into homeostasis.
Yeah, I'm stressed out now.
Have I completely stressed you?
Uh-huh.
Well, we also want to provide some answers.
Mm-hmm.
That's also what we're here for.
And it's a real stressful time for people.
Yes.
Now, I hear that all the time, and what's going on with the Obamacare and the economy. It's a stressful time. You know, a lot of things in healthcare for business owners like us, you know, there's more and more paperwork.
And you have
to go electronic, and you know, as I get older, you know,
as you get older,
when I was
ability...
in my 20s and 30s, I, you know,
sure,
do I, that, but...
well, I mean, what we were doing was pulling off of our ability, our hormones, you know, is one of the big areas that we actually pull from reserves on.
Mm-hmm.
And as we get older, we can't do that.
Mm.
They're just not as strong.
Mm.
So
we pull from there.
We actually pull from there is a good illustration. I mean, there's a whole chemical and hormonal type of a balance that I understand, mm-hmm. Which I am not going to get into.
Uh-huh.
Completely put our audience to sleep.
Are you talking about cortisol levels, things like that?
Cortisol levels. There's a whole shift on the hormonals that actually, you know, start to occur. The adrenals kick in, adrenaline, cortisol. There's a whole shift along those lines.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, the big things that we need to do is to actually, you know, do some good diagnostics.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
So as we can get into the diagnostics, we can actually understand what has gone wrong with the homeostasis because it's different for each person.
So what kind of diagnostics do you do?
Well, the blood work actually can show it up. And we can actually measure from your diagnostics, you know, the blood work,
mm-hmm.
How stressed you are.
Oh, how do you do that?
Well, there is a patterns on that. There's
mm-hmm.
The carbon dioxide levels actually can show up as far as a stress level. What the hormones, the balance, you know, the shift on the hormones, which we do a full panel on, we can tell that people are actually very stressed along those lines. There is several different blood tests. The pH starts to shift. You become more acidic.
Mm-hmm.
So I can bring up the blood work, and I can, even though they haven't said anything about stress, I said, wow, you are really stressed.
Mm-hmm.
And the person
you
goes...
You say it like that?
I actually say it like that. And the person goes, yeah, how'd you know? Well, you know, I can look at your blood work and tell it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, first thing is where is it? And different people actually put their stress in different areas. You know,
what
show
do you
up.
Mean by that?
Well, there are, you know, there are a lot of different types of people out there.
Mm-hmm.
And some people have a failure in the digestive system. Some people have it more in the hormonal. Some people carry it in their muscles. Different people actually carry their stress differently in their different organs.
Mm-hmm.
So they can actually have different types of failures that actually go on according to their body type, their constitutions, and just their personality.
Mm-hmm.
So
where they hold it.
Where they actually hold it.
Mm-hmm.
And we can also feel that as I'm actually checking people's, you know, doing the exam, as I'm checking the different areas. Some people hold it up in their shoulders. Some people hold it in their low back.
Mm-hmm.
Some people hold it in their feet. Of course, you know, I'm a chiropractor. One of the common things that people are coming in is low back pain.
Mm-hmm.
The most common denominator for people with low back pain is how much they enjoy their job.
Hmm.
So if people really hate their job, their chances of having, that is the most...
Interesting.
The most common theme and the most common cause of low back pain is that they really don't like their job. So
they're holding their stress.
Seems
like men hold their stress a lot more in their low back.
No, that's actually true. Feet. I have people who have curled up their feet and they carry all their stress in their feet. You know, so there is a very direct correlation. And once I get my hands on people, you know, I can pretty well tell where their stress level is. And when they come in, I said, wow, we had a really bad week, didn't we?
Yeah. Where do you hold yours?
I don't hold stress.
Mine is in my legs, isn't it? Because
times. Yeah. A little bit of restless leg syndrome. Yeah. When you are really stressed. So, you know, as we can kind of look at those different types of things, then we can pick up an awful lot of that. And how can we actually take it from there to work with that?
That's interesting, though. You know, you're saying people hold it in different areas.
Sure.
You know, they're coming in with muscle spasms or pain.
Interesting. One of the things that we're always trying to do is actually reestablish the homeostasis for people.
Okay. Well, up next, we're going to talk about treatments for stress and how helpful they can be. Listen to the Voice of Health Radio on your smartphone or tablet on all of the top radio apps available. TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, and iHeartRadio. You can find these apps and more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. This is the Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. Laughter is the best medicine.
Most we use holidays so we can eat more. You know, I normally don't have a burger, a brat, and a steak, but it is 4th of July. And I need the energy if I'm going to start blowing crap up. And that's what the founding fathers would want.
Are you frustrated by not getting to the root cause of your health issue? Are you tired of not knowing why you're always fatigued? Are you wanting to say no to toxic drugs? Have you lost hope? Are you just tired of being sick and tired? At the Prather Practice, we want you to know that we have the answers for you. We offer the alternative to the disease care model. We are the drug-free model to health and wellness. At the Prather Practice, we look for the underlying cause of your health problem and not just the symptomatology. Through thorough diagnostics, we find your individual health blueprint for your treatment. Where the disease care model is symptom-based, the structure-function model we practice gets to the root of your health issue. The Prather Practice is the most comprehensive wellness center in the Midwest. Our integrative practice offers you the most treatment options to restore your health and your hope. Learn more about the Prather Practice by calling 317-848-8048 or learn more on our website at the Voice of Health Radio and how it affects our health, which is pretty alarming, you know.
No pun intended.
Why, what did I say?
The alarm stage. That's okay.
At the time, I
like how you said stress. You do that well.
Did it sound like I was in the sympathetic nervous system? Yeah. That's usually where I go, by the way. We do have a punching bag down in our basement, maybe.
Hey, don't talk to me about talk about me like that. Yeah,
we put you in the basement. Actually, you've been very good for me on the stress level. I grew up in a stressful home, and I don't know if it's just Italians or, you know,
Well, you know, a very interesting thing is that some people actually think that you have to be stressed to accomplish anything. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's not true at all. You know, actually in the relaxation response, your brain actually works better.
I think that's what you've taught me, or just when to say enough's enough, you
sure.
know. You know, one thing I know that as you're working with people and healing people, I mean, there has to be a lot of stress. But I know you use the time from when you leave the office till you get home to kind of de-stress.
Certainly.
So you're not bringing it home. which, you know, your family and I appreciate, you know.
Right.
And that might be something, you know, to share with our audience, how you do that, because you're very good at that. I mean, I see you work, and I know what you, you know, you have to be on all the time. You've been called to heal people, and that's what you're doing.
Certainly. And people aren't necessarily in the best mood at that point.
No, when they're in pain. We have great patients.
Certainly.
And to see the transformation pretty quickly.
It's very rewarding.
Yeah.
But I have to be a calming influence.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
and you are.
That's basically what we're... And now, not all the time. There are times where I can be, you know, overstressed. I mean, you've seen me in that stage.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, I have actually worked quite strongly on how to work with that. My mentor, the gentleman that I actually interned with when I was out in chiropractic school and outside, Dr. Roy Sweat, taught me a tremendous amount about that.
Hmm.
You know, how to deal with patients, how to not let that get to you, how to actually keep a good homeostasis as you are even, you know, working on the patients.
Mm-hmm.
Because he said it was very important that you do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you could actually be good at what you're doing, because I'm doing a tremendous amount of thinking, a tremendous amount of problem solving on each and every patient, far more than the patients have any idea of what I'm doing, all that I'm going through.
Right. Sometimes I have to tell them, you are focused on them, you know, because sometimes they want more communication. I know you're so focused on
them. Certainly. Certainly. And I'm not just a natural talker.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's not, you know, so oftentimes I'm quiet. I'm actually going through a whole lot of processes on what's going on in the patient, mm-hmm. what would be the best route to actually approach this, you know, even sometimes figuring out exactly what actually has occurred on the patient.
Well, I make up for your lack of talking. Most of the women in the office do.
But it is something that actually learning how to do that is extremely important. And one of the things is that people are coming in, and one of the things that, you know, we are definitely trying to do is reverse this process in people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to actually make some dramatic changes, more than, because once you are actually stuck in this road, you're kind of stuck on it.
Mm-hmm.
People can't, you know, you sit there and one of the fun things is relax, relax, relax. And people are like, I can't. You know, if you're actually checking someone and someone's real tight, you know, tell them just to relax usually just tightens them up more.
Right.
You know, that doesn't really work. So, you know, we have methods of getting that shifted.
Mm-hmm.
And understanding.
Well, let's talk about that. You know, the treatments at our office. And I was just thinking yesterday, you know, people coming in, they had gotten acupuncture, and what a difference one session can make and just the stress. So what treatments do you offer at the Prather Wellness Center that help with stress?
Well, one of the first things that, you know, people can think of is the chiropractic. There are, you know, a tremendous amount of alignment that we do that will take off a lot of stress on the body. The nervous system is one of the great controllers of the system. So if you have pressure on the nervous system, shown by, you know, some misalignment, bringing that back up into position can dramatically reduce the amount of stress that the body has on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, having a consistent type of a pressure on the nervous system, imbalance on that, will produce a tremendous amount of stress in and of itself without any other outside stress.
Mm-hmm.
So as we get people lined up, people are amazed at how much better they do. You know, people say, wow, you know, I've had the adjustments and, you know, my cold and flu went away.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what you're doing is you're reducing the amount of stress on the body and all of a sudden you get a change. One of the studies that has been done is up in Chicago with Dr. Dickholt's office, was that this was actually a published study that chiropractic was actually more effective than blood pressure medicine on reducing blood pressure. Why is that? Well, you're reducing the stress off the body. Stress is one of the main reasons that blood pressure goes up. So you're making some huge physiological changes through the chiropractic. Sometimes there isn't actually a whole lot of misalignments that people have, but as they come in, we do some releases on the muscle. There are some blockages and locking up of the sacrum. As you can get that release, then you can actually get a tremendous amount of stress release off of that. TMJ adjustments. That is not always, but probably 70% of the time, temporal mandibular joint is caused by stress. You know, getting the jaw released, getting all these different types of muscles released, and people feel an immediate difference with the chiropractic care. Another, you know, the whole body work type of area. You know, you're talking about massage. Okay.
Right.
That is absolutely one of the most wonderful stress releasers out there.
We have a beautiful spa area too.
And that actually makes a big difference there.
I just, if I need to just get a little break.
Yeah.
Yeah, I go use the restrooms over there at the spa.
So that's when I can't find you.
Yeah.
I'm trying to talk to you,
no, that's
and all of a
you.
Sudden you disappear. I'm teasing.
Well, what about auricular therapy? I know there's certain points on the ear that help with stress specifically. And I know as I'm working with people on the auricular therapy, you just see their breathing change and
absolutely
a lot of them fall asleep and are so relaxed.
Certainly. And auricular therapy is electrical stimulation of ear points. And there are specific points on there for relaxation and anxiety, stress relief. And those are one of the ones that we always hit. But absolutely, what we're doing as we are working with auricular therapy, basically that's our brain therapy. The person who actually had made auricular therapy pretty famous was Dr. Norget, a French brain surgeon. And he had actually taken people's skulls off and had actually mapped the brain. And as he was doing that, he also hit points on the ears and found chemical changes, electrical changes in the brain. It's actually mapped and the most proven therapy in the entire world on its effects. And we use the auricular therapy for the body's perception of itself on how it actually changes. And anything that we think is locked up in the neurochemistry in the brain, that's the treatment that we go to. Addictions are extremely beneficial on that. Any type of mental illness, depression, anxiety, it's extremely effective. And absolutely, one of the things that has been documented is as you are doing auricular therapy, there is a huge shift in the physiology where you actually shift from that parasympathetic fight-flight over to a parasympathetic rest and digest. So that is one way that we can make a dramatic shift on someone and bring them right into that.
I can talk about that because yesterday our nurse practitioner was very busy and was getting a little stressed. And you were coming down the hall and I said, watch him breathe. Because you do that, the deep breathing all day long, and that keeps you in that parasympathetic mode, doesn't it?
It does.
And when people are in pain, just thinking of someone that was in yesterday, was having even a hard time sitting down, and you can just see him holding his breath. You know, if we just go, and I'm trying to learn that, just go to that deep breathing.
Sure.
Yeah.
And as I'm doing different types of adjustments, one thing that I do is reflex adjusting. And I'm actually working on shifting, and you can actually see their breathing change with the acupuncture, too. I had actually quite a few law students start coming in because they were going through, you know, their big tests, also some CPA exams, and the word kind of spread. And they were actually taking different types of medicines, you know, for focus, and one guy was taking actually Adderall on that. And he had heard about acupuncture, came in and said, wow, this works a lot better. You know, just because he was able to calm down, start to think, and actually function.
Yeah. Well, up next, we'll be talking about different things that you can do also from home to relieve stress. Never miss an episode of The Voice of Health so that you can stay informed and empowered about your health. Get a podcast of our show automatically delivered to you every week by signing up for our show on iTunes. You can find that link on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. And don't forget, thevoiceofhealthradio.com has complete archives of all of our past episodes with an audio library of information to help you add more life to your years and more years to your life. This is The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather. The Voice of Health Wellness Tip with Dr. Robert Prather of the Prather Practice. What is ECP therapy?
ECP stands for external counterpulsation therapy. And just to put it into a nutshell, ECP is an aerobic exercise machine. Now you sit there and say, well, why do you need an aerobic exercise machine? It is the number one treatment for cardiovascular disease. If you look at the research and want to find out, well, how do I fix my cardiovascular disease, you know, whatever it might be, always within the scientific literature, aerobic exercise is one of the most proven, most effective means of reversing cardiovascular disease. So, but the problem is I have people who I sit there and I look at them and I say, well, you know, what do I do about this problem that I have, Doc? And I said, well, go out and run 5 miles, you know, every day. And of course, they all laugh because you know, it took every effort that they had from going to the waiting room into the exam room,
right?
And they're out of breath. So that didn't work. So what was actually done was develop a machine that actually simulates the effects on the body of aerobic exercise, and that's where ECP comes in. And what occurs with ECP is that there's actually a second heart kind of put into the body.
Mm-hmm.
It's on the outside, but as the heart goes into relaxation, that's when it actually gets its blood. So what we do is we actually have blood pressure cuffs around the legs. It presses on the legs, and we get a huge amount of blood that goes back up to the heart. And the heart is very regenerative, and you get about 10 times as much oxygen with this particular type of treatment than what you normally would. And you get a regeneration of the heart. You also get a cleaning out of the arteries. And you actually get a huge amount of changes in the whole physiology of the body. So all the benefits of aerobic exercise are actually found in ECP, which are absolutely the number one way that you can be able to reverse cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and many other problems.
Schedule your appointment at the Prather Practice, 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Or learn more on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com. The Prather Practice, restoring hope. You're listening to The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather of The Prather Practice, where our mission is restoring hope to our patients. Today, we're talking about stress and how it affects our health. And, you know, we're just playing music, too. Music has a big role.
Mm.
I know, you know, as I'm driving to work,
absolutely,
what I'm focusing on is it, you know, for me, I need something uplifting and calming. And
music is a very big way that we can actually reduce our stress levels.
Mm-hmm. So. Now, before we went to break, we were talking about different treatments at the Prather Wellness Center that help with stress.
Mm-hmm.
Was there any others that we hadn't gotten to?
Well, there are actually a ton of different ways that we can actually do that. We have different types of modalities, diathermy. We've got like 12 different types of electrical stimulation. All of those
that
different types of things.
That doesn't sound relaxing.
Well, actually, a lot of them can take down pain and
right,
are actually very relaxing. Diathermy is, it kind of warms you up and gets the circulation going. People oftentimes fall asleep with that.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, of course, nutritional. you know, there's a tremendous amount that's involved with that. And as we help to achieve homeostasis, then we can get a big response on people. Getting the nutrients that people need, you know,
right.
You can be low on your B vitamins, and we can actually give different types of things that can have a huge relaxation type of effect on them. So if you are imbalanced in your physiology, you are low on different types of vitamins, fatty acids, amino acids, as you get those into the system and you get your body back into homeostasis, the body will actually start to do that response to actually bring you back so that you aren't stressed.
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the things that occurs when you are stressed, there's a wearing out of your digestive system, hormones, but also your minerals and vitamins. One of the things that we can see on people is when they're absolutely stressed. I had a wife told her husband and forced him to come into our office. Because in the business that they were in, there was actually the business was going down, and there had been three guys who had had heart attacks. And she says, you aren't having a heart attack. You know, you are stressed out of your mind. You go in and see, you know, Dr. Prather.
Mm-hmm.
And we did a blood test on him, of course, doing the diagnostics. And then I want to emphasize how important that is. And his magnesium was so low that the lab called me and with an emergency phone call said, you need to get a hold of this guy and get him on magnesium immediately. Because what happens, especially with males, is that they eat their, you know, when you're under stress, you use up a lot of magnesium. Women, it's usually more potassium.
Interesting.
But if you actually start to get too low on that, he was ready for a heart attack like any second.
Mm.
So these guys that are real stressed, high businessmen, they're out on the golf course, and they fall over dead from a heart attack, you know, unexplained, wasn't expected. Usually the stress has actually depleted a nutritional.
Mm-hmm.
Usually for men, it's usually magnesium. And they are ready to die from it.
And so
that's where stress can actually.
And you
kill.
Can find this out with your blood on the blood test.
Absolutely, that's why the blood panels are so important. And we told him, you know, stop at the first health food store he gets, and buy some magnesium. Start taking it. I said, which one? I said, all of them. And start to take it until you actually get some diarrhea. Then you know you got it up to par. And that saved that man life. He literally had less than 48 hours.
Well, you hear about that. You know, I was talking to a patient yesterday whose father-in-law, same thing, just, you know, died like that.
Right,
yeah.
Like that. And, mm-hmm. and that
there's something going on.
Sure, stress can kill you.
Mm-hmm.
Stress can kill you. And you can actually reverse a lot of that through meeting the nutritional needs, but of course you have to find out what they are, and we can find out exactly what vitamins, minerals, amino acids, fatty acids that you need that your body has actually been using up an over supply. And then once you actually have that down, it's hard to, you need to have supplementation to get it back up to par.
Okay.
And we do that through the diagnostics, so nutrition is absolutely critical on that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the other things that we have on that isn't, you know, found in a lot of places is homeopathic.
Mm-hmm.
There was actually a young lady who, well, not young, she was in her 40s.
That's young.
But she was under a tremendous amount of stress with family problems and other different types of issues, financial. And we had given her a homeopathic, and she said, oh, I love this thing. It has just changed my life. She says, as soon as I start feeling that panic, you know, she can feel her heart starting to race. She can actually take that homeopathic for what was her constitutional and feel an immediate change.
Can I get what she's getting?
Well, we put you on one. You are a sepia.
Uh-huh.
We can talk about that. And because everyone
and
has
you're
a
talking about constitutional remedies, yeah.
Homeopathic remedies. And if you get the constitution for you, then that can actually make a very big difference on your stress response.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you felt that before. Mm-hmm. You've taken that and had a calming effect. So people can actually have some homeopathics, and then we can actually design homeopathics for people's different types of problems. You know, at any age, I had a mother bring in her daughter. Her daughter had been not her usual sweet self. And I made up a homeopathic for pulsatilla, gave it to the daughter, and she called back and she said, I got my daughter back. And that was within, you know, 6 hours.
Wow.
And whenever she starts to see that, I need some more pulsatilla. So you can find those homeopathics that are specific for people, and you need to have someone who, for homeopathic to work correctly, someone who knows how to diagnose that, which I'm very good at, has a great understanding of homeopathics, can really check it out, get the right dosage, because there are, you know, literally a billion different settings for each homeopathic. So not only do you need to find out, there's 3,000 classical homeopathics, there's 8,000 non-classical homeopathics, there's nosodes, and finding out exactly which one is actually a real art, and you have to have someone who's very skilled in that.
Yeah.
So that's a great way to do that, and that's something people can take home with them.
Right, right.
And actually practice.
Well, let's talk about how we activate the relaxation response. That's kind of...
And that's actually a new thing. One of the things is Herbert Benson, an MD, who is doing a lot of research, and he actually started an institute on stress, found that not only do you just avoid the fight-flight, but you can actually activate a relaxation response. And there are different ways to actually accomplish that. And he did that by actually studying the people who do transcendental meditation.
Okay.
Now, you know, not necessarily that that's for people, but he had found and did a lot of research on people who meditated, you know, did deep breathing, did some clearing of the mind, and found that there was actually a huge amount of physiological release, and that there was actually a reversal of the damage that had of a lot of the not all of it,
right,
but of the general adaptation syndrome. So you can actually reverse a lot of that if you can get into and actually activate that that relaxation response. And there are many different types of ways to do that.
And it's going to be different for everybody, right?
And different people like different types of things. My big thing is I like to do Tai Chi. And that is very much right along the relaxation response. Yoga. I have patients who said, I've got to get back into yoga because it has, you know, changed my life on how I do things. Yours is tennis.
Being
active, you know, basically running around and hitting things.
Yeah, and the other thing I was thinking, meditation, it's hard for me just to sit still and empty my mind. But what I do is journal. And journaling's my type of meditation.
Sure.
Because that way I'm getting out by writing on a page what I'm feeling.
Oh, yeah, and that's excellent. You know, and looking at all
those... It's hard to get my mind blank.
And that's, you know, part of the whole personality type of thing.
Right.
You know, some people, it's just like yoga. Oh, you know, there's no way you're going to get me into yoga. You know, Tai Chi, there are people who have tried Tai Chi and said, well, you know, Tai Chi does not appeal to you at all.
No. Sorry.
Now, tennis is actually a very good thing. You think about it, one, when you have the fight flight, you know, you need to be able to run and you need to be able to fight.
Well, us ladies are funny. I mean, their time, we call it angry tennis. It's angry tennis time. We all know where, you know, what kind of weeks we've had, depending on how hard we're hitting that ball.
Yeah, and that's actually a great response because your body feels like, okay, you're beating the heck out of the tiger.
Yeah.
And you're also running around.
So we can name that tiger too, can't we?
So you can actually get a great response on that. And that's another way to do that. Another thing that we like to do is, you know, set the mood at night.
Yes.
You know, aromatherapy, smells are actually excellent. So we like to have,
Well, our daughter last night, who hasn't been feeling well the last couple of days.
Sure.
We put the lavender candle on for her. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we like to do candles. It's just, sure. Yeah.
Incense.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent way of actually hitting different types of ways of getting some relaxation. Mm-hmm. So smell is an excellent way. Candles, dimming the light kind of creates a different type of response on us. Taking a bath is an excellent way of actually, you know, creating that. Having a nice mood in your bedroom for
without the television.
Without television, yeah. Because that's not necessarily a great way to actually, you know, kind of get yourself all wound down.
Well, we have about 10 seconds to close the show.
One of the big things that I also want to point out is breathing.
Mm.
You know, one of the things that you mentioned, so breathing is extremely important.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Prather. We could probably even talk more and more on this.
Absolutely.
On this topic of stress. The Prather Practice is located at 8902 North Meridian Street on the north side of Indianapolis, just south of the I-465 loop. If we can help you to achieve better health, we'd love to hear from you. Connect with our office at 317-848-8048. That's 317-848-8048. Join us again here next week or anytime on our website at thevoiceofhealthradio.com for The Voice of Health with Dr. Robert Prather.